In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen. It's been quite a week. Some unexpected things happened. And some of you may think I picked out the hymns, or that I picked out these readings, because of what happened this week. We're a liturgical church, and these readings were part of our lectionary, year C. I did not pick out these readings. And the hymns were chosen weeks ago. That they happen to fit for what we're going through, that would be the Holy Spirit. And because things are always applicable from our reading of the gospel. So these words that Jesus said, nation will rise against nation, and kingdom against kingdom. There will be great earthquakes, and in various places, famines and plagues, and there will be dreadful portents and great signs from heaven. Jesus did not mean this election. He's talking about the end times. And there's a whole part of Scripture that is solely dedicated to eschatological matters, which is end time matters. When we get to the end of Pentecost and begin Advent, we're speaking about end times. The object of talking about the end times is to know where we put our trust. If the earth shakes, who do you look to rescue you? God, that's right. If you're feeling like your own personal earthquake this week, who are you more accessible to? God. Because we are weak people, sometimes we need to be shaken to our roots before we start asking for help. So I'm going to help you reach out for help and to have a little perspective on what happened this week. God, help me. All right. You can take a look around if you want, or you can just contemplate the many people of this parish that you know, some that you don't know. I can guarantee you that there are people here who did not vote the way you voted. I can guarantee you there's somebody here who didn't vote. There are others here who voted for reasons you would never consider. So we are called, especially by Christ, to be one in community, which means we have a heck of a lot of work to do. What this election and season before it, the last 18 months, has proven is that some of the rifts in our culture go way deeper than any of us ever guessed. So you better believe those rifts are here. If we do best to acknowledge the rifts and to try and make bridges. But it's not something that will come easy if any of us have been paying attention to television and a lot of the radio. They're not teaching us how to be tolerant. They're teaching us how to be hateful. We are not a people of hate. So, I'm going to read out of our baptismal covenant. If you want to follow along with me, on page 293, I'm going to remind us of what promises we make when we're baptized. I'm not going to read all of them, just the ones that apply. We are going to continue in the apostles' teaching and fellowship. We're going to be breaking bread, and we're going to be praying. We are going to persevere in resisting evil. And whenever we fall into sin, we are going to repent and return to the Lord. We are going to proclaim by word and example the good news of Jesus Christ, the gospel. We are going to seek and serve all persons. By serving Christ, we serve all persons, loving our neighbors as ourselves. And turn the page. We are going to strive for justice and peace among all people and respect the dignity of every human being. In our baptismal covenant, keep it front and center as we go through these next weeks of change. Now for a little social commentary. We don't know how to do this very well. If you are going to ask somebody who's on the opposite side from you why they voted the way they did, you better want to really understand why they voted the way they did and not be asking just so you can accuse them of messing up your world. All right? If you hear somebody crying, don't this week they haven't felt this vulnerable since 9/11. That may be hard to understand since this is not 9/11, but I can tell you that the members of minority groups feel extremely vulnerable, and the last time they felt this vulnerable was after 9/11. It has to do with vulnerability. They're not saying that something horrible at 9/11 happened. But if you're on the other side, it feels like an affront to sensibilities. If you're going to cry, try to do it at home. Try to do it with people you know sympathize with you. If you're going to condemn, don't do it in here. It's that simple. We have to honor our baptismal code, and we have to learn how to be civil again. We don't like the way the tone was this last 18 months, but we've been watching as things have already been shifting and falling into new places. There is nothing that the Holy Spirit likes better than a shifting of the ground under which we move our feet. Above, anyway, you know what I meant. We're trying to walk, and the ground is shifting. The Holy Spirit loves a vacuum. So what we need to do, all of us, is look for the power of the Holy Spirit acting in ours and others' lives. Look at what's shifting and think of something new that you can do that you have never done before. Volunteer for something different. Spend your time writing a letter, something productive. Reach out to those in need. I don't need to name all the minority groups that need to be prayed for. You know all of them. And we represent many of them, but especially our American Muslim neighbors are very scared. If you can do something to reassure them, reassure them. If you don't have the words, keep your mouth shut. We just have a lot of healing to do. What it boils down to is that when we side with our Lord Jesus Christ, you have to remember where he was when he was crucified. He was being victimized for his beliefs. He was being victimized for who he said was God. He died a minority group. Our solidarity is with Jesus Christ and minority groups. We have to continue fighting for them no matter how we voted. And we have to be able to have a loving heart to those who think they're better than we are. And assume they're not here in this church. Assume everyone here is building a bridge through their faith to a higher ground. This quote I saw a lot on Facebook. I belong to several priest groups on Facebook. All of them were writing about what not to say in your sermon on Sunday. And this is a quote that I heard many people quoting. It's by Abraham Lincoln. We are not enemies, but friends. We must not be enemies. Though passion may have strained, it must not break our bonds of affection. The mystic chords of memory will swell when again touched, as surely they will be by the better angels of our nature. Abraham Lincoln.